Hello again, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Mary Hanley. I'm with the University of Chicago Harris Cyber Policy Initiative. And now we're going to talk about one of my favorite issues, which is election security. Why is securing elections the hardest part problem in IT security? Joining me on this panel are my colleagues, Harri Hursti, Philip Stark, and Dan Weber. Please welcome them. So thank you again for joining us. In the years following the 2016 presidential elections, it's become evident that there's a lot that we don't know and are still trying to figure out about the security of our elections infrastructure in the United States. And some of these problems are issues that we're digging into through the DEF CON Voting Village and other research initiatives. But there are still a lot of questions to be answered. My colleagues on stage with me today are trying to answer some of these questions. Harri Hursti is founding partner of Nordic Innovation Labs and one of the organizers of the DEF CON Voting Village. He's considered one of the world's foremost experts on electronic voting security and has conducted studies in the United States and in 5 other countries. Philip Stark is professor of statistics and associate dean of mathematical and physical sciences at the University of California, Berkeley. He also sits on the board of advisors at the U.S. Election Assistance Commission and is on the EAC's cybersecurity subcommittee. Methods developed by Dr. Stark for auditing elections, called risk legitimacy audits, are in law in 6 states and in pending U.S. federal legislation. And last but not least is Dan Weber, managing partner of Nordic Innovation Labs. He's also one of our organizers of the DEF CON Voting Village and has served as CIO, CSO, CTO, and executive advisor to companies large and small for over 23 years. So to start with a pretty basic question, after all that we know that happened in 2016 and some things we don't yet know, why are we still concerned about election security this year?
We have conducted a number of studies for various of Secretary of State California, Secretary of State Ohio, and made public the vulnerabilities we have discovered. Everest, redacted version of Everest is over 300 pages of reported vulnerabilities. Still today, we are using the same software versions in various places in the United States. So even when we have reported vulnerabilities and recommended mitigation strategies, those have not been implemented. So unfortunately, there has been a lot of good progress, but there is a lot of places where there has been no progress whatsoever over a decade.
Great. Can you tell me a little bit about the Voting Village for those of us who haven't heard about it or haven't been to DEF CON? What is the Voting Village? Why was it started?
Before we started Voting Village, and Voting Village really is a room where we have acquired from eBay, from government surplus, and various of other sources, voting machines, and we just let people who are concerned to play around with the voting machines. It's not testing, it's educational effort. Before we started Voting Village, there was only a very small group of privileged people, myself, Matt Blazer, which is one of the co-founders included, who were part of these Secretary of State Commission studies and were able to study and learn the facts themselves. There have been a lot of information and misinformation on the public domain and in media. And what we want to do with the village is to enlarge the pool of people who have first-hand knowledge and first-hand understanding of the voting technology and vulnerabilities and where we are. And I would argue that single-handedly, Voting Village has hundredfolded the number of people who now have first-hand information and first-hand experience about voting security and how the machines work and what are the vulnerabilities.
So, speaking of these vulnerabilities, can you all give me some examples of vulnerabilities that have been uncovered through this process and others?
So we have two different kinds of vulnerabilities. One set of vulnerabilities are bugs, and those bugs can be either in a voting machine, voting software itself, or in an underlying operating system stack. The other set of vulnerabilities are dangerous features which are on purpose. For example, we found from a number of different manufacturers and models that there's unsafe update mechanism. Basically, if you have a file with a certain name, the machine without consulting operator will execute that program with the maximum privileges, allowing everything inside of the machine to be changed. That is a convenient feature, but obviously makes every other security measurement completely useless, because after that, you don't know what code the program, the voting machine is running.
Anything to add?
To the vulnerabilities that were discovered, my understanding is the vast majority of the exploits that happened in the voting village were things that had been known to someone beforehand, either through the California Top to Bottom Review, Everest, or other studies. That said, it was interesting how quickly people who had no previous experience with voting systems or voting equipment were able to find those exploits and act on them.
Just voting village or beyond?
All of the above.
I mean, everybody's aware. I mean, national news, Iowa, right? And, you know, if you look at that, that's not security vulnerabilities. You know, that's not even good IT technology testing and all of the other types of things that, you know, you would expect to see, right? And now you're seeing a lot of new technologies put in place, web-based, mobile apps, all of these other things that have their own vulnerabilities that are in place. And, you know, we as IT practitioners, having been in industry, we have a certain level that is expected. And the more that you get in and understand what isn't happening, you know, we talk about at the conference here, DevSecOps. We're not even at DevOps. In fact, we're not even at, you know, the idea of a hackathon, right? I'd take a hackathon, you know, related system versus what we're seeing out there today.
I would just want to add something what Phil said. That's absolutely accurate. Most of the DEFCON is not about proving that voting machines can be hacked. We already know that. It's about education. Most of the vulnerabilities discovered has been pre-known, but underlying vulnerability in the village, because people come with a different background, they find another way, new way to get to that vulnerability. The other part which is very important is most of the machines we have acquired has been used in elections in the previous year. So we actually, those machines have been just used in an election, and we have then those machines coming up with a 10-year-old software. So that tells what has been used in the previous election.
So if we take it as kind of granted that machines are vulnerable, let's talk about paper ballots. Everyone talks about paper ballots. Why is paper valuable in this case? What are the security properties of paper?
It's tangible and accountable. You can keep track of it if you're careful. It's human readable. You might need assistive technology, the people with ordinary vision are able to look at it without requiring technology in the meanwhile. It allows us to make an end run around all of the hardware and software that's in use in tabulating votes in order to verify whether the reported outcomes are in fact correct. That relies on a few extra assumptions. You really do have to have secure chain of custody, the paper, and the paper needs to be marked in a way that is itself trustworthy. One of the things I'm concerned about right now is a number of entire states are moving towards ballot marking devices for all voters, which put electronics between the voter and the paper record of the vote. The evidence is that people don't actually check whether the printout matches their intentions, and when they do, they don't tend to notice errors that have been even deliberately introduced. Paper is incredibly important. It lets you make an end run around the system. Ron Rivest is here in the audience. He invented this notion of software independence and strong software independence. And currently, paper is the affordable way of achieving that. There's some end-to-end methods, including those that Josh Benelow has worked on along with Ron, that may provide an alternative to that, but currently are not quite ready for prime time, although perhaps Election Guard is changing that. So all that said, if you have paper that you can trust because of how it was marked and how it was curated, then you can make an end run around all of the electronics that was used in the tabulation and confirm whether the reported outcome is really correct, whether the reported winners really did win.
All voting machines used today and all voting machines in the future will be hackable. The question is just how long it takes and what is the effort. Let's start from that. So while we have to improve the voting machines and voting technology, we still need to audit the results in order to gain trust and confidence that the election was carried out fair and square. Philosophically, elections are the cornerstone of democracy. Democracy is a method of peaceful transition of power. If you follow that train of thought, elections are not about winners. It's about losers. Because the peaceful transition of power is only possible when the losing parties and the supporters of losing proposals accept the results as a fair and square representation of the will of the people.
So, Dan, you mentioned Iowa, which everyone, I think, in this audience knows what happened in Iowa. There are a lot of new solutions coming out to our problems. When you're evaluating these solutions, what do you look for? What are you careful about when advising people? If they're a good idea, if they should be approached with caution, what do you think about?
You know, it's interesting. Being more new to the voting, you know, area and such, you know, there's standards that are in industry and you expect it to be there, right? Part of it is understanding what is the product look like. You know, we talk about all the time transparency. You know, understanding what's underneath the covers and that. You know, have people gone and independently taken a look at it? There's a lot of volunteer, you know, guidelines that are there in place today that they can go back against. And none of these guidelines really talk about security testing, per se, in the whole discussion. For me, when I evaluate any product, in which everybody here in the room takes a look at, you assume that, you know, things have gone through, they've gone through testing against a commercial standard that we all have done within big companies and that. And, you know, part of it is just really asking the question, right? You know, it's almost like knowing what's inside and going through and understanding who's tested it. You know, understanding then, too, a lot is what is the training that's available to folks and making sure that people actually know how to operate the system. And, again, at the end of the day, we all talk about disaster recovery. Paper is the ultimate disaster recovery because if everything else goes wrong, you've at least got something to go back to make sure that people can review against it.
I would start by saying, what problem does this new technology solve? Mm. And then look at what happens if it fails. If the technology fails, does it prevent people from being able to mark their ballots or cast their votes in the first place? If the technology fails, does it become impossible to reconstruct who actually won? So what we really want is technology used in a way that helps efficiency but doesn't undermine trustworthiness. That's really kind of it. Trustworthiness or uptime of the voting system, especially on election day when people are trying to cast their votes.
I think one of the misconceptions used in the media as arguing is to say that this system is tamper evident. If something went wrong, we would notice it. But the question is, then what? We don't do do-overs. So what happens if you detect an anomaly? Do you have a way to recover? And that's really what is important. Always have a way to recover.
So speaking of recovery methods, Philip, you're the developer of the RLA method, the risk limiting audits. Why should election administrators have them in place? Why are they valuable?
Well, first and foremost, we can't trust the electronics to do what it's supposed to do. We need to check it somehow. If we have a trustworthy, durable, tamper-evident record of voter intent, we can make an end run around the technology and check whether the outcome is correct or look for evidence about whether the outcome is correct or not. So the question is, how much looking do you do? And that's what risk-limiting audits address. They say that you might want to look more than this, but you ought to at least look at enough to convince yourself that the reported winners really won. So you're looking for strong affirmative evidence that the reported outcome is correct. You're never going to tally votes accurately down to the last vote. That's an unreasonable standard for accuracy. It seems like the lowest acceptable standard for accuracy is, did the reported winners actually win? Then the rest of it is, you know, kind of implementation detail, which of course is incredibly difficult and complicated because every jurisdiction has different procedures for handling its paper and storing its paper, and different voting systems have different technological abilities to either keep track of how the system interpreted a particular piece of paper or not, or, you know, this or that. There's just endless variations on this. You know, Ron sort of says that auditing an election is about almost as complex as conducting the election in the first place.
Elections are about trust, and voter apathy is as dangerous to the democracy as anything being manipulated. So first of all, regardless what you hear and what you think, always go to vote. Make your voice to be known. The second thing is auditing and risk limiting audit, which can be a public event, is a wonderful way for restoring public trust into the elections.
Yeah, I'm wondering if, you know, we used to watch the award shows and the accountants would come out with their white shirt, red tie, blue suit, much like the gentleman down here on the front row. And, you know, at the end of that, it would be certified by a public accounting firm, right? Because there are due standards, due process that's within accounting. And they've held on to the votes. They've been secure. And you feel good that at the end, the winner that gets announced, you know what I'm saying, was done in a right, you know, way and can be gone back and taken a look at. But, you know, nobody's jumping out from behind the curtain, right?
So I'm going to pile on to that. I describe what we currently have in the U.S. as procedure-based elections, where election officials say, I followed the rules, I did what the regulations require, I used hardware that had been tested and certified, therefore you can trust that the outcome is correct. And I think that's, you know, analogous to a brain surgeon saying, I followed the instructions, I used a sterile scalpel, therefore the patient is fine. And you might want to look at the patient to find that out for sure. So that's what auditing is doing.
To go back to what you all were talking about certification, can we talk about that for a second? Are voting systems tested to the same standard as commercial systems? Are they certified in the same way? Can we trust that they are what they say they are?
You're the expert here.
So, first of all, you said commercial systems. The old joke for decades has been, if builders would build the houses the way programmers build software, the first woodpecker coming to town will destroy the civilization. So our commercial software is not very good at all. But the underlying problem here is how we got into this problem. Help America, we had a problem in 2000 elections, and what America does very well is throw money to a problem. So Help America Vote Act of 2002 created a pile of money for everybody to go to the future shop and buy whatever technology they can find to modernize the elections. At that time, there was no idea of the world we are living today. At that time, cyber warfare was bad science fiction. These systems were never designed with a security consciousness in mind. And we are still using the same machines. Mm-hmm. So we have to also remember that not only these machines were designed in a completely different time, they are also getting old and tired. Over the years, computer scientists, security thinkers have been actually defining what the elections should be looking like, how to secure. Yet we have been very slow to implement what we have learned into the reality. So I think where we need to start is putting in place in mandatory security, enforced mandatory security standards, and make certain that those are being followed.
Piling on to Harri and that, you know, having come from the commercial side of the world to seeing this now, you know, I'm expecting any time Marty McFly to show up and he's come back from the future, right, with the machines we're using today. But, you know, so, and then you got the new stuff that you would expect, And that's not it's not a broad general blank, because there are some that we know are following right procedures. It's not fully out to market yet. But those other ones, just based upon evidentiary evidence of what you're taking a look at, no, we're not there yet.
So someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but the kinds of testing that voting systems go through don't include things like penetration testing, right? They have things like drop testing. If you drop it from a certain height, will it turn on again afterwards? They have some limited testing of the accuracy with which they interpret, you know, hand-marked paper ballots, if they're a hand-marked paper ballot-based voting system. But that certification is, how well did the machine do when it was brand new under laboratory conditions using machine-marked ballots? It's not how it behaves in practice after it's been kicked around a warehouse floor for 10 years and deployed by volunteer poll workers and so forth and so on. So the testing, to a large extent, is almost orthogonal to what we care about in elections today.
We have a completely wrong image in our head. We think that there is an election department, and the election department has a IT department, and there are security people somewhere there. That's wrong. Most of the election offices don't even have a permanent IT person. Mm-hmm. That doesn't exist. When we look at the amount of technology, both vote acting and non-vote acting, we look at the voter registration system, e-poll books, election reporting, all of that. The right mindset today should be, we have an ID department which happens to do elections. So the transitioning, the role and the technology and how the election environment works have transitioned, but the funding and resources, training and all of that have not been following. So the election officials are in very unfortunate situation with that. Even more, this is an asymmetric situation. Nobody would expect a local sheriff in a county to defend the country against a nation state rolling tanks in a land invasion force. But that's exactly what happens in an election. Mm-hmm. The local election officials are running against nation state level attackers. That's a very unfair game, but that's the reality we are living in.
So one last question before we open up for questions from the audience, for each of you. What can people here at RSA do to improve the situation as it currently stands? Is there anything?
On what time scale?
Before elections 2020.
First of all, if you are eligible voter in your country where you reside, go vote. Second thing is, if you care, become a poll worker. Mm-hmm. Poll workers, this is not a joke. The average age of poll workers seems to be going 1 year up every year. People who know and understand security, your eyeballs in a polling place, helping your fellow citizens to vote, and observe and report anomalies if you see, that's very important. So become a poll worker. Mm.
Use a hand-marked paper ballot if you can mark paper ballot by hand. In some jurisdictions, that might mean you need to request a vote-by-mail ballot. For instance, Los Angeles is moving to an all-ballot marking device in the vote centers and polling places model. So if you want to hand-mark a pre-printed paper ballot, you're going to need to request it ahead of time. They're going to have some kind of provision for a write-in ballot on site. But there are other places like Georgia that will also not have hand-marked paper ballots in the polling place. That's your best bet of creating a durable record that actually reflects what you meant. Lobbying your local election officials and or state officials to adopt more secure forms of voting if they either have paperless systems or if they're moving towards machine-marked paper instead of hand-marked paper. Lobbying your local election officials to, at the very least, try a pilot risk-limiting audit, if not adopt laws and regulations that require auditing routinely. Lobbying to try to get better regulations around the curation of the paper trail to make sure that the paper trail remains trustworthy throughout the whole canvas in the following audit and is available and secure for recounts or anything else that might happen.
Yeah. And while you're here, we've got the voting sandbox here. Take time and go and ask questions, read up on it, on the articles and that, learn, and go and, you know, teach other folks the same type of thing. Go out and reach out to others and make them aware that there are issues within the way you cast your ballot, right? Be aware of what happens within where you're at, and, you know, volunteer, like you said, to be a poll worker, and make sure that if they're not listening and if you see things that are not happening there, you know, make your voice known and make your vote count.
So one other thing, especially if you're voting using some kind of electronic interface, you bring a sample ballot with you. Bring notes for how you intend to vote, and then double check the printout against your notes to make sure it really reflects what you meant.
So we have time for a couple audience questions. If you do have a question for our panelists, please come to the microphone in the center of the room. Everything's being recorded, so want to make sure that your question is heard. Hi, go ahead.
I'm closest, so I get to go first. I hear a lot about people feeling a sense of distrust in the upcoming election. What do you tell people to encourage a better sense of trust if you yourself feel that way?
That's a great question.
So the surest way to ensure your vote doesn't count is not to cast your vote in the first place. So whether you trust it or not, go out and vote, as Harri said. I'm a big believer in trustworthiness before trust, and I'm actually a little upset with people who sort of say, what can we do to increase trust? Well, increase trustworthiness, and then talk about it. I think transparency is incredibly helpful, and adopting an evidence-based approach to elections rather than a procedure-based approach to elections. But.
Hi, I live in a jurisdiction with a president for life who I believe manipulates elections. What can I do to support a healthy process?
As said before, become a poll worker. Get into the system and look from inside. If you want to be, you can be a poll watcher. You can observe. There's a lot of rights for citizens to observe election, how the votes are counted. Observe.
Yeah, there's a thing called Twitter. So, you know, if you see things in that, raise awareness that way and get the attention of, you know, other folks that are out there, right? Because there are a lot of passionate folks out there around the, you know, election area and that. And, you know, by you see something, say something, right? And let other people know.
Thank you.
Great. Next question.
Hi. So I know that a few of you have, you know, you're giving advice about what the government will actually do for the elections with this, the election polling problems and whatnot. I'm curious about what you're actually telling them at this point. Are you saying, no, don't go with electronic voting machines, go away from that? Or are we far beyond that and you're just trying to say, well, do the best we can by the time it comes around?
If I start, first of all, United States, every single country has their own flavor of democracy. American democracy is complex. The ballots can be multi-page, they're very long, there's a lot of different choices. So America really needs to use technology in order to count the votes, but at the same time you cannot trust the machinery. So hence, it is the paper ballot, and it's a risk-limiting audit. Paper as an evidence, as every evidence in the world, has only value if you look at the evidence. So the other part is mandatory risk-limiting audit, every race, every single time. Don't make it so that the losing candidate or proposal supporters need to request recount or audit. Make the audits to be mandatory.
So yes, I have been writing letters to state election boards saying, please do not deploy ballot marking devices for every in-person voter. Right now, our best trade-off is hand-marked paper ballots for voters who have the visual acuity and motor dexterity to mark a ballot by hand, with ballot marking devices as an assistive technology for voters who can't do that in order to enable them to vote independently. Encouraging every voter who uses such a device to very carefully check that the printout, not the screen or the audio, but the printout reflects what they intended. And providing technology that would allow voters who need assistance to actually check that the printout says what they mean rather than having to rely on the device they use to try to mark the ballot to repeat to them honestly what they said. That right now is the best trade-off, I think. So.
And I think at the end, push, regardless of whether or not you can get the machines, other things put in place, make sure that you demand that risk-limiting audits be done at the end of the election, so that at least there are some steps in there to try to make sure of that the votes are being counted in the way that people wanted to be counted.
I think we have time for one more brief question. Sorry for those in line.
All right, so I'll make it quick. How much you think of this problem is actually self-inflicted, where we're trying to push technology where we don't need to? Mm-hmm. So when we look into business, they push technology to reduce their operation and gain something out of it. The fundamental thing for us here is trust, and we're losing trust by moving into this direction.
So the worst features of many of these systems are self-inflicted. They are either shiny and modern and inverted commas or snide marks, as my advisor used to say, or they're in the interest of trying to get preliminary results out instantaneously rather than allowing election officials the time they need to do a proper job. So I think a lot of it.
So thank you all for joining us for this conversation. If you have additional questions or would like to speak with any of our experts, please come visit us in the sandbox at our Voting Village pod. You can also reach out via email, and I will help get you to the right person. Thank you all so much, and thanks to RSA for hosting this conversation.